Break every chain. vain and please the Lord. And all we want is to play that music for you. It goes like this, the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major left, and all we sing is a broken hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life. That I would be saved. Chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nation with truth and justice? Shine like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You will lay down your life. That I would be saved. Take my place, that you would bear my place.
Sing me, I'm praying. very much. Well, we are in the season of Thanksgiving, and when is there not a season of Thanksgiving, right? And I'd just like to say I'm thankful for Luke and Johnny and Cameron, and for them preparing each Sunday, especially for today. Very, very nice. Very nice. Putting us in the position to worship. And we should always remember there's two primary reasons that God created us. You know, there's times people go, you know, why am I here? Okay? And, well, you may not know what your vocation is supposed to be, and you may not know who you're supposed to marry or if you're supposed to marry, and you may not know, you know, where you're supposed to live, but there's two things you can always know. You can know that God created you to worship with Him and fellowship with Him. Those right there at the top, to worship with Him and fellowship with Him. And so sometimes you wonder how people's lives get off track. Well, if you consistently worship God and fellowship with God, you're going to be challenged. People may think your life may be off track, but I just don't know if that can happen. If you're in consistent communion with God, worshiping God, I just don't know you'll ever get off track. Now, being off track is certainly a subjective term, you know. There are times where we are not happy with what we're doing. Harold, you were in the Army, right? Okay. There were probably days you weren't happy that you were there. A lot of days. But that was something that God wanted you to do, and you accepted, and we're grateful for that. But, you know, all of our jobs, they're every day, you know, God never promised that we'd be happy all the time. Now, His Word tells us that we can have joy all the time. You see, the reason we can have joy all the time versus happy all the time is because He is joy. He is the joy of the world. So the joy of the world never sleeps. The joy of the Lord never goes on vacation. The joy of the Lord is there all the time. And that joy of the Lord we can have. But that doesn't mean we're going to be happy all the time. Recently, I was working with some staff members, and we were having conversations about, you know, I have certain expectations that people that work with me, I love, you know, I mean, when you have, they're called core values, people have personal core values or business core values, and it's important if you're in a position of leadership that, and the leadership or and the group is counting on you. You see, we get this whole boss thing and leader thing kind of backwards. We think that the leader is, we think that the those that he's leading are to serve the leader. But Jesus had a different model. Jesus modeled that the leader is the servant. And the leader, just like parents, they work hard for their children. They sacrifice for their children. They lead their children by serving. And then hopefully children will learn that, and then they'll do the same thing when they have theirs. And then we also have a chance as children, if we're blessed for our parents to live long enough, that role can be reversed where we get to serve our parents. So, you know, this idea that being a servant is a bad thing, being a servant is the most blessed thing that you could ever be. And that's where Jesus used to talk about, we may think people in high places, those are the most important jobs. And He constantly reminded us that even the widow with two mites in the offering plate, you know, don't dismiss that, because none of us that are the most, anyone on this earth that seems to be the most talented or the strongest or the best voice or best musician, the most talented in business, all of that is nothing. Nothing without God. Because none of that will earn your way to eternity. See, all of this here is a gift from God. So let's say you have a a mining mogul who has discovered diamonds, and he's found these diamonds, and he's found a way to harvest the diamonds, and he's found a way to sell these diamonds, and these diamonds are just known around the world. He didn't make those diamonds. God made those diamonds. Or you find people in athletics, and they may buy a professional team, and they might hire this greatest coach, and they may just win year after year and just make money on top of money on top of money. They didn't create those players. God created those players. No matter what imagination a man or woman has to come up with something that looks so successful in man's eyes, and I applaud them. Wonderful. But let's not forget where that imagination came from. It came from God. The season of Thanksgiving is every day. Every day. In fact, we are in a time of a pandemic, and it's not COVID-19. Now, COVID-19 can be defined as a pandemic because it did touch every place on earth. But it cannot be defined as a true pandemic that it took a certain population of the world. Because if that were the case, you would have to say heart disease and cancer are also pandemics. Because it's on the pace, it was on the pace, now it's off the pace of heart disease and cancer. I will tell you the pandemic that is around the world. And that pandemic is lack of gratitude. And the lack of gratitude can spin so far out of control, it will make your life miserable. You go out to dinner. You're sitting there. You're having your dinner. All of a sudden, your tea glass runs out. You're one of those, you just like to sip between each bite. Well, now, your steak's getting cold. There's no tea in your glass. And you can't get a hold of somebody. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my goodness. What a first world problem. What a first world problem when there's places in the world right now that don't have clean water. I'm not saying any of this to make you mad. Now, I might be saying it for Miss Martha to say, boy, you did a good job today, man, getting on to us. Let's really get on to us a little more here, okay? But we need the balance of that. I don't like doing it because when I do it, I promise you, I'm thinking to myself, the times that I've been impatient. And sometimes I'm not impatient outwardly, but I'm just impatient inwardly. If I'm impatient inwardly, where's my gratitude? Where's my gratitude for the things that God has given me? Starting with shelter and vocation and health care and opportunity and education and friends and family. There is so much to be thankful for. And I'm substituting or using synonymously the word thanksgiving and gratitude today, but the lack of gratitude pandemic in this world, and I say in this world, there's places in this world that's probably not true. Missionaries tell us, when they show up, the people are so excited. They're so excited. Because it may be, these missionaries may be showing up, And it's the one and only time during the year the dentists come and pull teeth. I was asking my dentist the other day about his mission trips that he takes. And I said, just how do you stage all that? How do you stage all the cleaning and the fillings and things like that? And they just chuckled at me. They said, we just pull teeth. They get people out of pain. It's not cosmetic. They're not doing the smiles. They do the smiles here to make money to go on mission trips and pull teeth. Gratitude. Those of us that's had the privilege of going to, I don't even know if you call anything a second world country, but just go outside this country. I'm not condemning the entrepreneurs that built this country. That we should be making things better. We should be providing for more and more. We should be training more and more and challenging and providing, startup opportunities for business. But we should be very, very, very careful that we are never in a position of not being thankful and not having gratitude. Okay, so there's the bad part of the sermon. The good part of the sermon is what happens when we are grateful. Or let's say you're going to have a trial tomorrow. I mean, something's going to happen tomorrow, just unexpected. Junior, every day this week we had a trial up there on that building project, didn't we? One day the dozer breaks. One day a dump truck breaks. One day, we lose a person helping us. Another day, a guy has to go to the doctor. Every day there's something that happens. And it doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter who you are. If you have something that happens, you just stop and be grateful for what you do have. It'll wipe it away. God will wipe it away. He will. His word tells us that. Okay. Cameron, were we able to get those slides of the history of Christianity? Okay, if you could, just pop that slide up. So, in the history of Christianity, we all know about, I tell you what, if I could do it all over again, it would be history and English and maybe Latin, okay? History repeats, language is involved in communication, and the Latin language is just the origin of so many things. But in history, we know about, the Bronze Age and the Stone Age and all that. Well, there's different ages. Well, in Christianity, there's different ages too. This is a very, very compact outline. I only have four eras of Christianity. In Christianity, we have early Christianity, and that was the beginning of Christ. And you're going to see things like every one of these are broken out into sub-ages too. But just for our purpose today, we have early Christianity, and then we have the Middle Ages. And, that goes up to, 18th, 19th century or something like that. And then we have modernism, which is kind of where we're somewhere between modernism and postmodernism. Now, let me read to you, or actually we have a definition of postmodernism, okay? Slide 2. Postmodernism is an exceptionally harmful ideology and grave threat to Western civilization, because you can tie Western civilization, the history, with Christianity for the most part. From its anti-rationality roots to its hostility to logic and reality, it is an ideology that will destroy the West if it is allowed. You seen anything like that lately? Have you ever seen anything on TV that lacks logic and reality? Such as defund the police. Is that not just insane? Or all of the efforts to battle the modern definition of racism, which all it's doing is causing more racism. It's causing division. All the efforts that have been done before and even since Martin Luther King Jr., they're being attacked. They're being torn down. It's almost like it's in reverse. To help you understand it, think in terms of we're on the threshold. Some people say we're all the way in it. I'm the optimist, and I'm just hoping that we're not. Anti-rational roots to its hostility. It's not just that there's a lack of logic and reality, a hostility toward logic and reality. Can we just say truth? Do you see a hostility toward truth? Of course we do. There's only one religion that's attacked in this world, in the worldwide media, starting right here at home, and it's Christianity. Well, that shouldn't surprise us. Jesus said it was going to happen. He said, listen, we just read it 3 weeks ago. The world hated me. You ain't no better. It's going to hate you too. But, he said, I have brought you peace. You will overcome. So, I began to look up any prophecy, and I'm going to continue to do that this week, toward this postmodernism. Now, we know that it's in there, but it's the words are not in there. But Jesus prepared us for times like these. And by the way, there's always been times like these somewhere in the world. There's always been persecution since the time that Jesus left. There's been Christians have been persecuted somewhere in the world. And dictators and authoritarians have taken advantage of people all around the world. By the way, has anyone in here heard of a documentary movie called Free Burma Rangers? If you haven't heard of that, I will give you $20 to buy it. And you can watch it right in your home. Or come to my house and you can watch it. I've already bought it. It's wonderful. It's an unbelievable story about a missionary kid that felt like he was more of a soldier than a missionary. So he joined the Army Rangers. And he did that for 10 years. And then he felt God call him back to the mission field. But the mission that he gave him was to go to Burma, where the authoritarian and dictator rule, no place on earth was it more dangerous just to be a human being. It didn't matter who they just would just slaughter villages. The Burmese army would just slaughter villages. And so they were constantly running and moving and setting up a new place in different parts of the forest or jungle. For 20 years, he and his wife and three children lived in Burma and train people how to defend themselves with their hands, with sticks. He started by getting them in shape so they could run. And they live in just hill and mountains and unbelievable. And to see these kids walking and carrying other kids on their back in baskets is just unbelievable. He prepped them to escape and keep their lives. And of course, as a missionary, they were learning about Jesus. And so that's all I'm going to tell you about that. I mentioned that because as I watched that, and Carol and I watched it together, the gratitude And actually, the lack of gratitude in my life was exposed as this family truly has sacrificed for others. I want to say I've done that, but not compared to them. And it's not important that we compare to others. So you have to fight that battle too. Okay. Now, all of that was to set up our verses for the day. I'm going to read three that have to do with thanksgiving and thanking God corporately together as we come to worship. The first is Psalm 95:2. Come, or let us come before Him with thanksgiving and extol Him with music and song. I'm telling you, thanksgiving and gratitude, it just warms the heart. It gives you courage. It gives you strength. And we are worshiping God. Remember, worshiping and praising God, one of the two primary purposes of which He created us. And then Hebrews 12:28-29. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful. Our inheritance is fixed. Heaven's not going to go away. Heaven is guaranteed. Eternal life is guaranteed. It cannot be shaken. Let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. Are we really pausing? Are we really contemplating? Matt, are you really taking the folks in this message to the point of understanding the magnitude and the majesty of God, our Creator? There's only one Creator, and it is our God, who's always been, who'll always be, who made everything we see. We are grateful, Lord. We are grateful, and He's a good God. He's a righteous God. He's a just God. Hallelujah. And Psalm 100, verse 4. One more click. Psalm 100, verse 4. Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name. If we weren't on live stream today, I would just be passing a microphone around, you know. And, you know, isn't it amazing when we do that, it kind of puts us on the spot. And people are going, oh, what are you thankful for? And what's the first thing? Family, friends, you know. But if you really were to, you know, I got to thinking, maybe we need to just kind of drill down. Okay, family. Which family are you thankful for? Call them out by name. What are the things you're thankful for? Lord, thank You for all the things You've given us. Okay, list them. Like that beautiful old car that you have, Harold. How about that tiller? Those tools we have. Ladies, any of y'all still have curlers? You thankful for your curlers? You thankful for that mirror that's got a light on it? Everything we have, every good thing we have comes from God. All right, and then we'll close with five verses. There's a little sequence to these. It starts with this, James chapter 1, verse 2. So, individually, throughout the week, let us be thankful and consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds. So when are we to be thankful? When there's a trial. When there's a problem. But what's our natural reaction? Now, I'm not talking about hitting your thumb with a hammer, Harold. That's kind of understandable if you've ever hit your thumb with a hammer, okay? But when there's a trial, when there's a problem, I mean, as a believer, if we're worshiping consistently and fellowshipping with God consistently, the natural will be more spiritual. Our spiritual will become natural, and just thank God. Psalm 50:14 is going to talk about sacrificing. Just as we mentioned that family a moment ago. Sacrifice thank offerings to God. Fulfill your vows to the Most High. I know there's times where people, especially during Thanksgiving and other times, that people are being grateful and thankful, and they go through the drive-thru, and they'll buy theirs, and they'll say, oh, I want to buy for the person behind me too. Showing God gratefulness and thankfulness by sharing with others. Giving sacrificial. And when you talk about sacrificial, that's a little different story. That's when you feel it. You know? You see, if you got two hamburgers and you give one away, that's a gift. But when you got one hamburger and you need the hamburger and you give that away, that's a sacrifice. You can feel it. It's something maybe that you're not going to do for yourself and you're going to do for others. Sacrificial giving. Being thankful. Thank offering, specifically. If we were to really drill down on that, it's a lot more to it with respect to the tradition of our Jewish heritage and in their worship. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Doesn't specifically say during a trial, but it'll work for that as well. Just as we learned in James 1:2, but in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, we're to give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. We're to give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. If we're worshiping Him, if we're in fellowship with Him, we're going to be on His track, which is the right track. And on those tracks, Jesus said, you will face trial. You will not only face trial, you'll face persecution. And then 2 Corinthians 9:15, thanks be to God for His indescribable gift, and we could take time and lift gift after gift after gift, beginning with His Holy Spirit. And then finally, 1 Corinthians 15:57, but thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, victory. Victory, victory. Victory in Jesus, victory in during trials, victory during persecutions. And I'll tell you this too, we need to have victory during victory. Because how many times does a victory turn bad? Not long ago, I saw a team win a ball game, and they were so excited, they were jumping around, and their star player broke his leg or broke his ankle during the celebration, and he wasn't ready for the next game. So, we just don't need to lose our minds when we're victorious, and one way to do that is to remember who brought the victory. You know, we're on the screen saying we're going to Disney World. How about thanks be to God? And a lot of guys do that. Thanks be to God. Because He gives us the ability to dream, to imagine, to work, to compete, to learn. This is a season of thanksgiving. So it's good to remind us to be thankful. But we should be thankful all year long. You know, April 15th, remind us to, you know, had your business due with Uncle Sam. Well, that's not the only time of the year that we're, you know, working with our finances. You work with them all day long, all year long, but you have to focus during that time. So this is just a time of focusing on thanksgiving and gratitude. And so today in the message, we talked about be careful, because if we're not grateful, we can think too much of ourselves. And then when we're going through trial and persecution, or just troubles and problems, just remember, Don't do them alone. And gratitude will help you through those. Let us pray. Father, thank you for everything. We thank you for these scriptures that reminds us of what to be thankful for. And help us, Lord, to encourage one another and help us during this season of Thanksgiving to really focus and do almost a spring cleaning of our lives. And help us, Lord, to be specific in our Thanksgiving too, not just for our family, but for those in our family, and help to pray for those in our family. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. If you'll stand, we'll be dismissed today. With this blessing from God's Word, may God Himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. And may your whole spirit, soul, and bodies be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Have a wonderful day and a wonderful week.